Alright, so we examined our list of good and bad websites, and from that we put up a list of design guidelines. And a few things to say is how do I want to say it? These guidelines, you know, guidelines is a good word for it, as opposed to say rules or laws, because really everything depends on the specific project that you're working on. So if we talk about clear navigation and this and that and this and that, there are times when you might want to break or bend those rules. All right? Can anyone think of a case where you might want to bend or break the rule of, say, having the purpose of your site clear or having clear navigation? Can anyone think of an example where maybe that wouldn't be something that you'd want to do on a website? Yes?
Like a lot of websites where you have to sign up for a free trial, and then like after 30 days you have to deactivate it or it charges your account.
Right.
I find that those are the sites that are very hard to find the deactivation button.
Okay. That's actually a good point. I guess depending on how you want to look at it, in cases of like deactivating your account, it's not in their interest to make it clear. They want to give you the ability to do it, but it's not in their interest. I guess another example would be, and I don't really mean these. I'm going to give a couple examples because yours is a great example. Another one is a site that is intentionally deceptive, you know, like a site that for whatever malicious or what word do I want for deceptive reasons purports to be something other than what they are. I guess that's another example. But I'm thinking about just straightforward web design. The one case where I can think of is, if you had some sort of site intended for like entertainment, something that was like game-ish, like a game, that you wanted people to spend some time to explore the site, all right, where you don't necessarily make it obvious right off the bat what the site was about, all right. Instead, you let people spend some time exploring the site. And I'm going to bring up an example. I hope I can bring it up to illustrate what I mean. I don't think the site is active anymore, but we can use the Wayback Machine to go back and find it. I'm not joking, by the way. Oh, it is available. It doesn't have a comma on the end. It has CL. All right. I love bees. All right. So when you first click on this site, it works pretty quick. So it's going to sort of flash on the screen. Keep in mind, in the old days when you had slower connections and slower computers, this took us a little bit longer. But if you click on this, I love bees, and whoa. We get an error message that looks ominous. Sort of in the background, you can see a site that looks like maybe a site from the early 2000s that could be dedicated to beekeeping with the cursive font and I love bees and all that. But you get this sort of goofy error message, and if you click on this emission log, there's a little audio clip. Some cases there's audio clips. I think other cases there's text. Well, maybe there isn't. Does anyone have any idea what the site was actually for? It's obviously not about beekeeping. Yes?
Wasn't it some kind of like marketing campaign?
It was a marketing campaign for the first Halo game. Yes. All right. So this is like a big example of what people use when they talk about viral marketing, you know. And they describe it in Wikipedia as an alternate reality game, seemed to be a real-world experience in a viral marketing campaign for the release of developer Bungie's video game Halo 2. Okay, I thought it was the original Halo. All right, and so on down the line. All right. I Love Bees was first advertised in a hidden message in the Halo, and people that visited that go through it, and you do that. So, in that case, part of the fun was figuring out what this is supposed to be and figuring out the message there. So, they created a sort of a game-like effect by deliberately making their site be something other than what it seemed. All right? I guess the reason I point this out is that when we talk about clear navigation and all these things, those are guidelines that just about anything we can think of in terms of a web design guideline, there might be cases where you would want to break or bend that rule. So these aren't hard and fast rules. These are guidelines. Now, to be sure, if you were doing a website for a law office, for example, and you thought, gee, that worked well with I Love Bees, let's make our law office, the website for this law office, I Love Spiders, all right, and do the same thing. No, it's not going to work, all right? It's a different project with a different intent. The people coming to the site have a different purpose and a different intent, and therefore you must be aware of that. It really all comes down to goals. People visiting a site for a video game have different goals than people visiting the site for a law firm. Therefore, you would not take the same design approach with both of them. So, that's our word of the day, is goals. We're going to talk a bit about this, and then we're going to talk about your project. All right? Goals are what is hoped to be accomplished by the website. That's from the perspective of the people making the site. Both the people making the site and the people visiting the site have goals. All right? So I will say the creator of the site, whether it be an organization, an institution, a person, etc., they have some goals for making a site. What it is they're trying to accomplish by creating a site. Alright? The consumers of the site, the visitors to the site, also have goals. All right. Now, ideally, there'll be enough overlap between these goals that you can make for a successful site. Or maybe put differently, when you design a site, you will want to accommodate both the goals of the organization that's creating the site and the goals of the people visiting the site. For example, let's talk about a college. What would a goal of the college be in creating a website? Your college, you're making a website. What do you think your goals would be?
To attract students.
Number one, one of the goals might be to attract new students, to convince people to attend your school. That might be one goal. What might another goal be? Yes?
Convince people to attend their college with statistics and stuff.
Repeat that, please.
Convince people to attend the college with statistics and things like
Okay. Try to make the point that this college, the college that you're creating a website for, offers some advantages over other colleges. Alright? Whether it be by statistics or whatever. Alright, yes?
College websites are usually also for like the students that go there, so like we have Canvas and My Campus, like a portal.
Exactly. A college website is to provide certain services to the existing students. All right? Because if you think about it, you know, it's great if you can enroll right online, right? If you can enroll in your classes online. Then you're not going to have lines going out the vast library doors, right, when it comes time to sign up for new classes, right? So that's a service that you want to provide to your students. You want to serve your customers. In this case, the customers being students. All right? So anyone think of other goals? All right. Now, what are the goals that the consumers, the visitors of this site, of a college site, what would some of their goals be? Yes. Right. Someone that is considering going to the school to see if they have a program that they're interested in. You know, maybe you are interested in mobile software development. Does this school have a program for mobile software development? You know, to find that out. Or to be a dental assistant, or to be a welder, or whatever. All right? So find out if the college has a program that meets what the student or prospective student wants. What's another goal that someone might have in visiting the site? College's site. What have you used the college website for?
Make a payment.
Make a payment? All right. A goal might be to transact as much business as possible via the website so you don't have to come down here. So you don't have to drive and park and walk and that sort of thing. So that might be a goal of people visiting the site. Or just attending classes online. The goal might be to get your education online. All right? I visit Oberlin College's website frequently. Now, am I planning on enrolling? No. Am I currently a student there? No. Why do you think I visit their site? Yes. See what events are available. Absolutely. All right. Oberlin College is a great conservatory. If you like music, it's a great place to go and hear students and faculty members play music. All right. So I visit their site to visit them, to see if there's any events that I might be interested in. Now, here's an interesting thing. All right. When we talk about the consumer or visitors of the site, there's really different kinds of users visiting every site. Different categories of users. And each of those categories has their own goals, right? I'm not looking, when I visit an Oberlin College's website, I'm not looking to see if they have a program for philosophy or anything like that. I'm looking to see, well, what recitals are there this coming weekend? That's a different goal than someone thinking of visiting Oberlin College. So one category of user of people visiting a college's website might be members of the community. By the same token, I can imagine people visit LC's website to see what's going on at Stocker, or to see what's going on at the film festival, or to see if any of the athletic teams are playing. All right? What are some other categories of users that might visit LC's website? Well, a couple of them are obvious, right? We sort of already have mentioned them, right? Other groups of people besides members of the community.
Students and future students?
Yeah. Students and potential students. Future students, if you want to be optimistic. let's just brainstorm. Let's think of all the different kinds of people that might visit LC's website, besides the groups that we have up there now. Yes?
Any parents?
Parents. Yes?
Teachers.
Teachers or staff. You know? Hey, what's the latest changes to our dental plan? You know? I might go, seriously, I want to go and visit our site, and I would hope that I can find it quickly. All right? Where's some other possible people that could be visiting LC's website? Yes?
Employers.
Employers. Oftentimes, you know, we'll hear about someone is looking for someone that can do this job or that job. One thing I would suggest all of you folks to do, and I'm not really sure what their rules are, but to consider going to employment services and talk about possibly getting an internship. All right. Now, there's some rules, like about how many hours you have to take, and have taken, rather, and your GPA and all that kind of stuff, but and I don't know those off the top of my head, but go and visit them. They have workshops about writing resumes and interviewing, and it's a chance to get an internship. If you're planning on going in any sort of technical field or software development, web development, the best way, a good way to get experience is to have an internship. That's one thing that can differentiate you from everyone else that is applying for like an entry-level job. But it's true. Employers will look to see, like, gee, I need a web developer. Who should I contact about that? All right. Other groups of people. Yes?
Competing colleges or companies that want to see what you're doing?
Yeah. I don't know if I would use the word competing, but I'll just say other schools for whatever reason. So yeah, it might be kind of competition, you know. But it might be for just for other reasons, just to see, you know, just to get ideas, you know. I've looked at CISS programs for other colleges, not because I, like, and they only have to be in the area, not that I think that LC is competing with those, but just to get some ideas, just as sort of a way to sort of reasonableness check our plans. Like, we have these courses, what courses do they have? Can I get some new ideas from them? But, yeah, that's a visitor to the site. Other ideas. We could probably come up with a whole bunch of these, right? Now, the one I'll add one more group to this, and for no particular reason, but I do think it's a good example, is brand new students. Given that brand new students might need just a little bit more hand-holding than just a regular student. You know, people, like in this classroom, I assume that most of you have been here already a few semesters, so you know your way around. You probably don't have to ask where the cafeteria is or the library is or whatever. But someone who's maybe the first time on campus, the first semester, for the few weeks, might need a little extra hand-holding. You know, how do I apply? How do I use my financial aid? What are the bookstore? That kind of thing. All right? Now, really, if you're going to come down to it, you know, every individual is going to have their own goals when they come to this site. All right? So, I don't know what, there's 300 and some thousand people in Lorain County. It's kind of difficult to build a website trying to accommodate the needs of 300,000 individuals. So you got to categorize it a little bit. You got to put people in categories. And how many categories you're going to have? Well, it depends. A big public institution like LC serves a lot of needs. One that I would add to this would be a displaced worker. Now again, a displaced worker is a potential student, but that's a little different than a potential student, let's say someone is graduating from high school this year and thinking of coming in. maybe someone that worked for a company for a while and their company went out of business and they need to gain some training to get another job. They're going to likely have different goals than a student that's graduating from high school that's looking at entering college. All right? So I'll call this one high school students. So what do you do? You can't build a website. You can't survey 300,000 people and figure out what everyone needs and build a website for them. You come up with some categories, all right, and you decide which categories are important to you, all right. Looking at these, I would say that really all of these categories would be important to me except for maybe the other institutions, all right. Even those are important to me. Why are those important to me? Because we have partnerships with many of those organizations. So I actually changed my mind about that. That one's important too. Alright? Now, each one of these organizations, each one of these groups of people are going to have some goals. Now the goals might overlap. Alright? A goal of a displaced worker might be to find out the expense for attending schools. High school student might want to find out expense. A parent's certainly going to want to know about finding out expense. For teacher and staff, that's probably less relevant, right? Current students, that's probably relevant. Members of the community, well, it depends what they are looking for. Maybe in some cases they are interested in the expense if they're thinking of coming here. Maybe if they're just thinking about Stocker, you know, visiting a performance at Stocker, they're not really interested on what the tuition charge is. So there might be some overlap between these different groups of people in terms of what their goals are. All right? But there might be some big differences. For example, a displaced worker might want to be interested in, can I get credit for my work experience? Whereas someone that's graduating from high school and coming here, probably that's not really a goal of theirs. All right? So each of these groups has some goals. All right? We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 different categories of people. And I think these are very reasonable categories. Each one of them is going to have some goals. Some of those goals, all right, are going to overlap. Some of them might be high priority for some groups, lower priority for other people. All right? An employer might not be terribly interested in the calendar of cultural events on campus, but maybe a member of the community really is more interested in knowing about the cultural events at the school, and so on down the line. And these goals might have different priority for different groups, all right? Parents might, yeah, they might be interested in what cultural events are, but that might not be one of their top priorities. They may be more interested in the expense of the school and what programs the school offers and so on. And somewhere down the line, they may be interested in that. All right? So, hopefully there's enough overlap or that you can develop a site that accommodates both the goals of the creators of the site and the goals of the consumers of the site. Keeping in mind that when we talk about the consumers of the site, we need to break them down into groups. All right? Now, in the case of this, this is a lot of different groups that have a lot of different priorities. Well, that's the difficulty in developing a website that serves a lot of different people, different kinds of people, all right, and still make it user-friendly. And different schools take different approaches to this, all right? One thing that you often see on a college's website is you will see these categories written. Are you a current student? Are you a prospective student? Are you a parent? And they'll have links just for those things. Let's look at LC's new website and see what it does. Now, keep in mind, I'm not holding this up as a perfect example of a website. You know, we can comment on this objectively. We don't have to praise it just because it's our website, all right? I'm not saying it's an example of everything good, but let's look at this from the perspective of the goals. All right. One thing, notice right off the bat a couple things. All right. Faculty and staff. There's a separate link for them. All right. The hope is this will accommodate the things that the people that our faculty and staff here need to know and information about them. Student resources, academic resources, paying for college, career services, and so on. Business services. Remember we said that local businesses might be someone that would be visiting the site. They have a area of the site devoted towards those folks. And finally, community services. So one thing that LC does is they almost have links on their homepage related to certain categories of people right off the bat. So you know where to begin, all right? And getting started would be for the people who are just thinking of coming here, all right? Personally, if it were me, I would label this prospective students instead of getting started. But, everyone has their own preference. Let's look at some other colleges. Let's look at Cleveland State's. Apply, visit, give, alumni. Whose navigation do you like better? Cleveland State's or LC's? That's Cleveland State's. That's LC's. Let's just focus. Let's forget about the rest of the page. Let's just focus on this stuff right here. The main navigation at an LC or the main navigation at Cleveland State. I would actually give the vote to LC. And I don't think LC is necessarily a perfect website, but it's much more clear for me where I would go if I was a business, for example, coming to this site. If I ran a small business and I wanted some training for some of my people, it's much more clear where I would go to. Here, I have no idea. All right? If I was a brand new student, I might understand that admissions relates to that. But getting started seems to be a much more simpler view, all right? Where would I go if I was faculty staff? Well, maybe there's a link way down here, all right? They have those links, interestingly enough, but they're buried sort of at the bottom. Don't get that, all right? At any rate, what I like about LC's is it seems to be more in line with the goals that of the people visiting those sites. Now, let's get to talking about your project, because your project, you're going to first develop a design document. What I mean by a design document is going to be a document in Word that's going to contain text, rough drafts of web pages. So there's five parts to your design document. Let's talk about those, and let's go to Canvas and review those. Here's the document. Before you create a website, you have a very clear idea of what the purpose is. To assist you in the design process, you'll create a design document that addresses your site strategy, your site strategy, scope, and structure. All right. I hate when teachers read to me what's on the board, so I apologize for doing that. I was halfway through that before I realized I was doing it consciously. Planning is the key to almost any big job, right? Who's a carpenter on PBS? I think it's Bob Villa, all right? I don't know, like This Old House years ago. I forget sometimes how young people in this room are. He was probably on in the 80s or something, and like, you know. But anyhow, he had a saying about carpentry, and he said, measure twice, cut once. All right? And that makes sense, right? Make sure you know what you're going to do before you do it. So if you're going to cut a plank of wood, make sure that you have planned it out, how big you're going to cut it before you cut it. Because once you cut it, if you didn't plan it right, it's going to be a pain to correct. And almost any endeavor is like that. If you write a paper in English, all right, I know what people do, and that's not the best strategy, all right? I know people don't pay attention to their English teachers and follow all the steps, like making an outline and doing this and doing that and doing that. I know that because when I was a student, I never did that, all right? So I assume students haven't changed. All right, English teachers probably haven't changed. So I'm assuming it still goes like it used to go. You will do much better if you plan your papers, if you take the time and outline instead of just sitting at the typewriter. Wow. Now, yeah. If you sit there with your quill and scroll, and yeah, if you sit there at Word and just bang out and type your paper off the top of your head. It's much better if you have it planned out. All right? Exact same thing with websites. So that's why I'm stressing this. That's why this is a big part of your assignment. Not just making the web pages, but planning them out first. Now there's five sections. The first section is the strategy section. And the strategy section is about two main things. It's about identifying the different categories of users are going to be visiting your site, all right, and defining the goals, both for the creator of the site and for the different categories of people that are going to be using that site. Now, there's a specific name given to the groups of people that visit your site. In this case, we had what I've been calling categories of users. There's a specific name for teachers and staff, parents, potential students, and so on. And that name is a persona. All right? A persona is a representative of a typical group that's going to be visiting your site. So I want you to create three user personas. Each of those personas should be representative of a group of visitors of your site. And what do I mean when I say create a persona? You actually make up a fictional person. All right? I'm not joking. All right? You make up a person. You can give a photograph of the person. You can take a picture of your friend. All right? Or take a picture you find online or whatever. And then you write something about the characteristics of that person, including what their goals are. Let me find an example of personas. It's a little hard to read because it's so small, so I look for a bigger image. You can Google this to find more information. But here's an example. This is a website for an online shoe store. All right? The profile is narrow feet. All right? Brandy here's got real narrow feet. All right? She's female, 36, lives in Los Angeles, makes $38,000 as a receptionist. Motivations. Brandy gets very emotional about shopping for shoes in retail stores because she rarely can find a pair that fits her narrow feet. Recently, she has turned online shopping, blah, blah, blah. Here's her goals. She wants to find an SS, maybe that's a European size thing or something, but 4A with shoe. She'd like to purchase several pairs to fit occasion, style, and color, hoping to find that she doesn't have to sacrifice style or options when searching by fit. They actually went one step beyond, and they actually found real customers that are representative of their group and got actual real-life quotes from them. So you don't need to do that for your example, but what you do need is you need to make up three people, three personas. And each of the personas should represent one group of people that your site is aimed at. All right? Now, for profile narrow feet, you could specify any sort of special needs, right? I kind of have big feet, all right? So it's not always easy for me to find shoes. And shopping online is a good thing because, like, if I go to a store, I might see a style I like, but it only comes up to size 12 or whatever. All right. Whereas online, I can get a size that fits me. All right. Why do you think we do this? Why do we go to the trouble of making up a person, give them a real name, talk about what job they do, where they live, give some description of some, you know, what motivates this person, define their goals, and talk about their frustrations? Why do you think we do that? Yes?
Like, if we know their occupation, we know the price range that they might be looking at, if we know where they live, we might know, like, a particular style or something they might have to feed into.
All right. Yes?
Probably to create scenarios for how we can make our website look.
Exactly. We do this to humanize our users, to put a human face on them, so that we can think like they are. In other words, you talked about scenarios. When we're done with our site, we should say, when we're done designing our site, we should say, hey, how is Brandy going to achieve her goals? You know, how is Brandy going to find shoes that fit her? And we should be able to define from our design, oh, that's easy. Brandy would go to our homepage, click on this, bam, she sees a list of shoes that are meant for her. All right? As we're designing this, we should always keep these people in our mind, because these are the people that we're developing our site for. And again, narrow feet, yeah, that's one particular example, but you could substitute anyone with special shoes needs. What would be another kind of persona for someone shopping a shoe store?
An athlete, maybe.
An athlete. Or someone who has a specific needs because of the job they do. I'm thinking someone that needs like work boots or something like that. So someone that needs a very specific kind of shoe, style, whether it be like a work boot or an athletic shoe or something like that. All right, that would be another persona of someone visiting the site. All right? Let's find another example. Oh, this guy looks like he's going to be fun. A craft brewery. The profile is James Wade, who is a hipster. Male 28, he's an artisan baker. Oh, this is too funny. Needs an all-in-one solution. He wants to just go and brew his own beer, but he doesn't want to have to shop around. All right? Because he's cool and he has a lot of important things that he needs to do. He needs to go to art gallery openings and he needs to go to concerts. And he doesn't have time shopping around. He'd like to try a variety of malt, hops, and yeasts. Doesn't want to spend an arm and leg for quality ingredients. So that would be for a craft, some place that sells brewery supplies, a persona. Okay, this is another one for clothes, and so on. You can do this regardless of what topic you've chosen. All right, I'm going to throw up a couple examples of a potential project, and you tell me some personas that will fit that. All right. By the way, your strategy section, what it will contain. It will contain a brief description of your site's topic and purpose. So, for example, a shoe store. You know, I want to create an online shoe store. Blah, 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 blah. Create three user personas. A prioritized list of three goals for each of the personas. A prioritized list of the three goals for the creator of the site. Like, the shoe store probably wants to sell more shoes. That would be one of their goals. And then finally, it should look professional. It should look, it should be done in Word and read like a report that you'd give to your boss. It shouldn't just be, spend some time and attention formatting it to look good. So that's the first part of the design document. A brief paragraph that describes the purpose. Your three personas. Three goals for each of those personas. Three goals for the creator of the site. And make it look professional. So let's come up with a couple of topics for a website, and you come up with three personas for each of them. first one, video game. I'm a video game developer and I'm going to develop the video game. We're three personas of people that might want to visit my site. Yes?
Some random teenager that likes playing video games.
Okay. So, teenage gamer. It's another one. Yes?
A pro player.
Interestingly enough, I didn't know until not too long ago that there was such a thing as someone that plays pro video games.
$20 million prize pool.
Pardon me?
$20 million prize pool.
Really? Wow. Wow. See, it's, you know, tell my kids, you know, put down the video games and study. I made a grave mistake, apparently. Should have told them, keep playing them games. Get good. What'll be another example? Yes. Maybe a hardware manufacturer. Yes?
A parent.
Another one? Here's one I'll put myself in the category of. You know, just a casual gamer. Someone that just wants to pick up the game and play it for a half hour and does not want the game to be more complicated than their actual real life, all right? Which seems to be the case of some games, right? I would rather go and live my life than deal with some of the issues in games. These are all people who have distinct needs, all right? And you could come up with a list of prioritized goals for each of them, all right? To determine, to help them determine, is this the right game for me? That would be a possibility. You know, a parent might want to know about the content of it. Parent might want to know about the expense. The parent might want to know about in-game purchases, I would think. All right? Many of these people might benefit from a demo of the game, or at least like maybe a, you know, screen captures or video gameplay or something like that to get an idea. All right, so you can come up with goals for each of those. All right, what about a band? There'll be three personas for a band. Yes?
A musician.
All right, another one. Yes? Fan of the band. Another one.
Events.
Pardon me?
Events? No,
that's not. Well, that would not be a person. Maybe if you could think about how you could rephrase that or reword that to get your idea across. Yes.
Record label. Venues.
Booking a band. Very good. That's sort of related to events. Yes. Okay. What about people that are? I'm gonna put it this way. Non-fans. All right. Now, when I say non-fans, I don't necessarily think like someone that hates the band. I'm talking about people that maybe have never heard the band before. Maybe I see that a club that I go to in Cleveland has a band coming up, all right? And I might know, just based on the fact that I visited this club before, that I kind of like the music that the band, the venue typically plays, but I want to see, is this a good band or not? Or maybe I like the style of the music that they play. Maybe I see it's a jazz band, and I think, well, I like jazz. I wonder if I like this particular jazz band. So people that aren't familiar with the band would be a different persona, all right? And again, all these are going to have some goals. They might be overlapping, All right? But they might be different as well. All right? someone's agreeing very strongly with me out in the hall. It's not... It seems hard at first. Let's do one more before we finish. Sometimes people will come up to me and say, I have an idea of my topic, but I can't think of personas. Almost any topic, if with a little bit of time, you can come up with three personas. All right? What about a restaurant? Yes?
Critics.
A critic?
Customer?
Customer's a little broad. Who's a typical customer that visits a restaurant?
People that like eating.
That's right. Hungry people. All these are true. All right. Let's think about people that might have different goals and different needs when visiting a restaurant or restaurant website. Yes?
Kind of like what type of food they want.
What type of food? All right. So it might be... one thing might be someone that is likes specific kind of food. All right, that might be a possibility. Yes?
For dietary restrictions?
All right, people with dietary restrictions. Family going out to eat. A couple going out on a date want to go out and eat, right? Talk about groups that have two different, you know, those two groups kind of have opposite goals, right? They're looking for two totally different things, you know? But they may be visiting a restaurant's website to see, is this an appropriate place for me and my date, or for me and my family. What about an organization planning an event? I'm thinking like maybe we're having my company meeting, and we're going to go out to dinner afterwards. So I need 12. Do they have like a banquet room where like my 12 or 20 people could all be in a room separate from the rest of the crowd? Something like that. All right. This is the goals. I spent a lot of time on the goals because that is critical. If you don't define the goals, then the rest of your site's going to flounder. If you have a good idea of the goals of you and the people that you're developing the site for, then you have a much better idea in developing your site. We'll talk a little bit about more goals next time. To kind of wrap up this section, then we'll talk about the other four, because the other four go pretty quickly. All right, so we'll wrap up goals, talk about the other sections of the design.